school out, they can't afford to run a curriculum that doesn't secure a good progress measure. And I have to say, whilst Jill was absolutely right, it's a very secondary focus to that, that primary and key stage two in particular is absolutely being forced to mirror a lot of that secondary logic with a very narrow focus on core English and maths. The real hope is in early years and in key stage one where it's better, but the trauma for schools is that head teachers are infinitely less autonomous than they think they are, than they've been told that they are, because they are so well controlled now by a measure of effectiveness that predetermines the curriculum. For those of you who don't know, forgive me for boring you, but Progress 8 is made up of three categories of subjects, and English and maths are worth double. And then there are the next tier of subjects, which are languages and humanities, and by humanities we only mean history and geography, that those subjects are then absolutely enshrined, which means that the time left to run that third group of subjects is only what's left over. And in that comes everything else, all the vocational qualifications, DT, IT, media, all the ologies you can think of, anything else that people want to do has to go into that third bracket. And so the reality is that the arts will survive in secondary schools if their subjects are delivering well, if they're getting good results in that third pot. That's just a trailer for the real problem. And if we could have had Nick Gibb here, or somebody from the Department for Education, I think we need to listen carefully to really understand what they think. So Steve was talking to me about the frustration of not having that case better articulated. So I've come, remember I did say I was a drama teacher, to just pretend I'm going to roll as the other side for a moment. I'm still a member of ASCL. And ASCL have produced a paper called The Question of Knowledge. And I just checked out in the break, it is a free publication. Google it, The Question of Knowledge, Parents and Teachers for Excellence, or ASCL, just put one of those in. But The Question of Knowledge, it's really worth downloading. Because in the introduction, it will begin to show you what the real problem is. Michael Gove was not a one-off phenomenon. He wasn't a freak who just achieved a huge revolution in a few years all on his own. He enacted and lived out the result of a whole shift that came from the States with the work of Hirsch on a knowledge curriculum. And that's the problem. It's the knowledge curriculum, it's the idea of mastery, that says that all learning is about pouring in knowledge and then measuring it as it goes into these empty vessels, that is the root for everything. And what really shocked me when I read this paper was that there are people I know and respect writing in it. And so, basically, the belief is that the only way to achieve social equality and social mobility is to give all children the knowledge that then means they can start to participate in everything else. And the trouble is, and the danger of it for primary, is that you're not going to really achieve mastery until you're probably a postgraduate somewhere. And until then, you're just going to go on receiving the knowledge. So this is what one of the contributors to this paper said. For pupils to participate in, extend, or even undermine discourse around them, they must be handed down the knowledge of the conversations, of the discourse. This is the essence of freedom. For example, you can place a pupil in a chemistry lab and tell them they're free, but they wouldn't know what to do with all that freedom. However, if you induct them into the conversation that includes knowledge and traditions of chemistry handed down through the generations, they would be in a powerful position to make a difference as a human to that conversation. That same writer then goes on and works a really good example of art in his school, and says that because we were introducing a knowledge-based curriculum, we made all the faculties, all the departments, change their schemes of work to match. And he reflects the journey his art department's come on, which is a very simple one. It is dropping art and introducing art history. And it's dropping drama, in the way you brilliantly described it, and turning it into an extension of literature and a text-based subject. And that is the real danger. That's why there's no respect for anything that sniffs of a child-centred piece of learning. There's no respect for the idea that expression and giving voice is appropriate, because all of that was the misguided wishwash of failed comprehensive education that was expressive and woolly and half-baked that failed children from poor backgrounds. So there is a social reforming passion in the dogma that means that Nick Gibb is only interested in English and maths taught in an instructional way so that 9-year-olds can tell you what frontal adverbial clause is and things like that. And that's what SATs has become. And significantly, the measure of school effectiveness is being more and more and more honed down to those things. And the Ofsted inspection framework is focusing more and more and more on those things because there is a deep philosophical belief behind it. And so it's worth understanding EBAC's inadequate language to talk about what our problem is. It's the growth of that kind of curriculum, which is now what's dominating GCSEs, which is why it's becoming a knowledge-based system of memory testing and literacy in pretty much every subject. And anything that isn't that is instantly condemned as being of no worth. My anxiety is that if we simply say the arts are the same as PE and they're about kind of a general set of transferable skills, the knowledge-based folk will also say that skills are not transferable. And as a head who passionately cultivated a skills-based curriculum, there's a big challenge there. Because actually a lot of skills aren't that transferable, and you need to have excellence in a discipline, in an area, or you need to have it working well to be able to really value the skills. The challenge of transferability of skills is a tough one. And if the arts are simply reduced to generally contributing to these nice skills, then we're on very, very thin ice. So, last night I was speaking to a colleague head teacher who told me about a year 9 child who just committed suicide. And that reality of mental health, the national crisis of permanent exclusions and children dropping out of the system, reflect the fact there's a very high attrition rate, a high failure rate in the kind of curriculum that Nick believes in. The good news, because Steve needs me to finish, is that schools ultimately are quite fickle places. And heads want things that work. So all that talk about where the arts is working, it's true. If we can make the arts work, and if you look at really outstanding schools, judged by outstanding according to Ofsted terms, you will find all that wider life there. The challenge is how we make sure that happens. Woo! Hey, Tim.